shows itself evangelist in big data. And I think that after you have your technology right, you have your data, you have your impact, then there is another very important aspect that comes with it, and that are the ethics. So I'm happy that we have this topic also on this conference, and I hope you enjoy the talk. He will give you the possibility to do some interaction during this session. So have here a microphone, I will ask my colleague. So please, when you have a question, give your name and also the company. Thank you. Enjoy the talk of Richard.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I'll try to be able to see hands up. It's a little bit difficult with the lights up here, but we'll see what we can manage. I hope you find it interesting and challenging. There will be time between when I finish and when we finish, before I go to the airport later on, somewhere around 5:30, 6:30 is probably. So if you'd like a session with me, do talk to the management events team and arrange a private meeting or a table meeting or whatever sometime in the afternoon. What I want to look at around the theme of ethics and trust kind of highlights some of the stuff I've been doing on LinkedIn over the last few weeks. Is a question of should we? Oh, by the way, that little link there will take you to my personal website, and you will find a PDF version of these slides. So you don't need to take photos, they're there with a whole set of notes. It's PDF'd in the notes format, so you can get at it, and I'll ask the organisers to make sure that you all know where the link is. Now, the forum context started off with these five items. I want to look at the bottom two. In terms of your individual, as leaders, relationships and responsibilities to ethics, big data analytics, and the question of embedding a data-driven mindset. Now, I'm going to address this slightly diagonally, but I think when we've finished, you'll all begin to understand some of the consequences of being leaders. This is a broad outline of the progress through the next 50-odd minutes. I want to look at a few questions about what is leadership? What does it really mean? And I'll then lead through that into a couple of questions that are of incredible importance to me about leadership. There's lots of other ones, and I'll briefly cover those, but the ones that I found incredibly important in my own life in the last 4 or 5 years has been the role of leaders above me to inspire, to enthuse, and empower. And then from that, I want to lead into a set of interesting questions about the data that we're acquiring, that we're trying to use, the analytics algorithms which we're trying to use. I want to also very briefly look at the question of big data compared with small data. And I'll also bring in the middle of that, some consequences of the new general data protection regulations that are coming in May 25th, 2018, because they are incredibly consequential. They're some of the best piece of legislation that I have seen in many, many years coming out of the EU. They are the most important and most powerful drivers for better use of big data and analytics that we've ever seen. They have a huge impact on you, and I suspect many of you are really rather unhappy with them. I know Google is very, very unhappy. But it will do, or may well help to rebuild trust in big data with some of our customers who maybe don't distrust us quite a lot at the moment. First, a couple of pictures. Are you managing from behind, organizing, fixing, getting things organized? We need managers, but what's your role? Are you there organizing stuff, or are you up front leading your teams into a secure, sustainable, ethical type of environment? only attributes of a leadership, of the vision for the direction where we're trying to go? Have we got that passion that helps to convince and bring our people along behind us? Think back to some of those incredible photos, now 100 years old, of the officers leading their troops in the First World War up out of the ditches and into the fire. Think about what that meant, that passion, that vision. Leadership is about walking the talk. It is not about the managerial perspective. Here's a set of rules for you guys, but because I'm a manager, they don't apply to me. Is that where you're at? Or are you walking the talk? Leadership is about communication. It's about telling the story in words and in concepts and ideas and emotions that connect with your listeners, your staff, your teams. I'm reminded of a lovely story of a British politician about 3 or 4 or 5 years ago. And he had a particular idea that he wanted to communicate to the electorate. As a politician, he should have known the rules of communication. The fundamental rule that you are responsible for choosing the words, the message, in terms that your audience understand and associate with. He forgot that lesson. When his listeners, his readers, rejected the message, he then said, effectively, "They're too stupid to understand what I'm talking about. That's why they didn't listen to me. That's why they didn't agree with me." The fault actually, obviously, was with him. He didn't think about who his audience was. He didn't think about how to tell the message, the story, in terms that they would empathize with. The fundamental art of communication. And yes, we do need a lot of courage to break the mold, to stand out from the herd. Go back to 2004, 5, 6, 7, and lead up to the credit crunch in 2008. Many of the executives of those banks and financial institutions that were affected, they were uncomfortable with what was going on, but they dare not step off the merry-go-round. They dare not stop until the music stopped. Otherwise they, too, would lose their jobs because they weren't following where the herd was going with profit. Very nearly destroyed their own companies, and some companies were destroyed. Now, my story starts a long way back. I've had a 40-year, roughly, career, including 3 years at university. Started off at Rolls-Royce Aerospace, spent a lot of time at Rolls-Royce until 2000, and then transitioned to become an academic. Now, most of my career at Rolls-Royce Aerospace up in Derby, I had new jobs, new roles every 18, 24 months. Almost every single one of those was a new role that hadn't existed before. Certainly from about 1980 or so was when I started getting all of these roles. And every single one, or virtually every single one of my managers allowed me, empowered me to do things that hadn't been done before. Then in 2000, after I'd helped lead be part of the team that implemented SAP across the whole of the company, the whole of aerospace, I left and eventually ended up at the University of Derby. For many years there, I was a traditional sort of academic. Got lots of cool stuff to pass on to my students. And then four years ago, I had two new managers above me who were both inspirational and empowering. And they gave me the courage as well to change dramatically from pouring knowledge into the heads of my students to something totally different. To guide and mentor them. So that instead of telling them what the answers were, the facts they needed to know, I was allowed and encouraged to actually do something very, very different. To point them to where the learning material was, but more importantly, to get them or to provide them lots and lots and lots of questions that they could then go and research. Now, for an academic, that is an incredibly difficult and dangerous place to go. How do you know that you're going to actually achieve the same levels of success, the same levels or better levels of achievement by getting them to do the research and the learning? It turned out that applying learning analytics was what gave me the answer to that it's a better way. Those two guys, one of them, Richard Hill, has just published a book about leadership in academia. And that I just ordered it, so I will start reading it, no doubt, tomorrow. But it's a very interesting thing. There are few leaders, really inspirational leaders, in many parts of academia. A lot of it is managed. You'll do this, and if you get lower results, gosh, you've got to think about your job, mate. But these guys had the courage to encourage me and lead me and inspire me. So that's kind of interesting. I was inspired, I was empowered. It's that empowerment which is really critical. You learn from mistakes. You will not have your legs chopped off because you made a mistake, as long as you learn from it. It's kind of a bit like part of the agile methodology. Make mistakes quickly. Yeah, but let's get it right quickly as well. Learn from our mistakes, improve it. In the field of analytics, in the field of the use of big, middle-sized and small data, we need to be thinking very, very carefully about how we mentor and lead, inspire our staff across the whole board, right from top to bottom of the organisation, to think about what information and knowledge is all about, how it helps all of the stakeholders in an organisation. In academia, for academics, it means being the sage on the side, standing there helping develop all of the soft skills they need. It turns out, on our analytics programs, we don't need to teach, in a formal sense, all of the academic or analytic packages, whether it's SAS, Excel, SPSS, Tableau, SAS Jump, Click. We get our students to learn those in their own time. We've got much more important things to use our time with them, our contact time, to help them to learn to identify questions, to formulate questions, to identify how to then solve those problems. We don't need to spend time on the technical aspects. They do that, it turns out. We then spend a lot of time now in this particular program helping them with their soft skills. So in the first year, we spend a lot of time, not teaching SAS, they learn SAS, we teach them in that that module all about communication, about structuring their right ideas so they can write compellingly. We teach them how to tell the story. Because one of the things you guys have been telling universities around the world is that, yes, our graduates from university are technically pretty good, but they are absolutely useless in terms of employability because they have none of those relevant, important soft skills. So that's what we're doing. And that was a big thing that came out of this empowerment to give me and my colleagues on that particular program to develop, not to teach technicalities, but to actually to guide and develop and mentor all of those soft skills that you guys value so much, that makes our graduates employable. It actually has a very interesting side effect that the level of degree that they achieve is actually much higher. It's rather interesting, by not concentrating on the academic topic itself, but getting them to find out by being given questions, but concentrating on guiding and developing their communication skills, they become more valuable and better achievers. Interesting. So that came out of that enthusing and inspiring and empowering. Maybe there are some lessons around, perhaps, for some of you. I don't know. I want to move now from the concepts to something clearer, closer at home, to the conference theme of analytics. I go back to the United Kingdom's UK Companies Act 2006, and in section 172, there are six or so responsibilities of board members, the key legal directors of the company. Of the six, I want to use as a background for today the first and the last but one, that in all decision making they need to consider the long-term consequences and likely consequences of any decision. And then the desirability of the company maintaining a reputation for high standards of business conduct, business ethics, shall we say. One thing I should mention here is that the rest of this session is going to be looking at a lot of failures. This is not cynicism, it is deeply critical thinking. Could say skepticism. We know what has happened at Uber in the last 2 weeks. Kalanick having that rant to one of his drivers. The possible theft of intellectual property by their car company Otto from Google Cars. And then the bottom two are about gender discrimination, sex discrimination. The poor lap girl on the right, Susan Fowler, and a new exec of Uber who had to resign after less than a month because of it that he did not disclose during the recruitment process that he had had some sort of incident like that alleged against him. At least Kalanick had had the grace 3 days ago perhaps to say, maybe I need leadership training and help. An amazing failure of business ethics in that company. An astonishing arrogance that the laws do not apply to Uber, whether it's licensing or whether it's getting the right license for driving your driverless cars around California and so on. Very, very intriguing as to why that is happening. Now, one of the problems we have is that we're all looking at big data, the stuff that's out there in our corporate databases and coming from vast numbers of IoT type of sensor devices, whether it's a GPS tracker logger or it's your tills in your supermarkets. Corporate data in the SAP or other ERP type systems, whether it's coming from smartphones that your clients and customers use, or even these little fitness trackers. We have a problem that was identified some 5 years ago now by a guy called John Easton from IBM, who posed the question, or made the observation, but 3 years from then, 2012, he was saying, by 2015, we will have a veracity problem. We will not know, we do not know, which of our data are correct and which of our data are incorrect. We do not know for that data which is incorrect by how much it is in error. Now, when I first saw that at a SAS conference down in Marlow in about 2013 or 14, it was interesting, because I looked at that with my background of many years at Rolls-Royce, involved as a systems analyst and many other roles, that if you look at, that's around about 15% for the enterprise data, and all the rest is the 80%, I thought. So I thought, okay, right, enterprise data, that's the stuff we can trust, probably. And then I looked back and reflected and realized, as having been part of that team that onboarded the data out of our legacy systems, all 400 odd from Rolls-Royce into SAP, we did a serious data cleansing exercise. We threw away something like 70% of all the data that was cluttering up our master databases and other things. And I kind of thought that that was the solution. We now had clean data, until I heard stories from around the world that, yes, we did do that when we implemented our new clean data into ERP systems. But then stories around about 2007, 8, 9, 10 started coming out that said, many of the companies are now, 5, 7 years later, having to do major data cleansing exercises again. That data that we thought was in SAP or Oracle or PeopleSoft or whatever has got contaminated. I was reminded only a week ago, I was looking at one of our little systems built inside PeopleSoft where we have personal tutoring arrangements for between academics and a number of our students so that they know who to come to talk to. And I was looking at some of the data, I looked at which college, which faculty in the university I worked for. And it turned out that it was a college that I was in about 5 years ago. Somehow the HR processes hadn't updated that particular bit of my data. Now, it's going to stay like that probably for the next 5 years. Because A, it has no impact on me. It is absolutely no consequence that I'm miscoded in that part of the system. Second, I haven't a clue who to turn to get it fixed. Can't be bothered to walk over to the HR department or email them. Why should I? It has no consequence. If I'm down on the list of modules, and there's a section that says these are the modules you're leading, it is of no consequence to me whether that's right or wrong, because I can always find the modules that I want to look at and the student list and so on. So there's no consequence. Now, I make that point because there are so many occasions when there is no consequence to having that erroneous data in operational terms. But it does have consequence when you start trying to use analytics. To learn something, to get an insight about the organization. So everything in there is potentially contaminated, and everything there is very difficult often to identify. That one is easy to identify, probably easy to fix, but it doesn't change what I do. But much of the other things, I'm going to look at a few today, where the consequences are actually significant. Now, you all know your smart devices, your smartphones, you can get location tagging of your photos. For a wide range of reasons, those location tags are not terribly accurate. The first one from a few years ago, that one, was at a conference and took four or five photos in a little restaurant with only wooden ceiling. I was taking photos of the food, and I was a bit horrified when I got back to the hotel and the internet connection to discover one of them was tagged 22 kilometers from where I was. I then looked at another app where I was standing. Up there. And while I was standing in the TK Maxx, it took me all the way around there in about a couple of minutes. Not quite speed of light. But it's not just assisted GPS that has a problem. This one is at home. I put that tracker you saw in a photo a couple of previous slide or so, put it out there for 24 hours, taking a reading every second. That distance from there to there is about 10, 15 meters. Sitting out with good visibility of the satellites. If you do it in the conservatory over here, which is that one was taken from there, and in there with a bit of plastic ceiling and glass, those distances there, that day's worth of tracking, something like about 40 meters across. I've got photos which are tagged up to 1,000 kilometers in error. Now the consequence of that is if you are a retailer trying to do targeted location-based advertising, you're Starbucks, and you want to tell someone, here's a good offer in the Starbucks you're just outside in, say, Derby. Nice if you're in Derby, a bit of a problem if you're 40 or 50 miles away, 80 kilometers away in Sheffield. You might suffer a reputational hit because you're getting effectively spam advertising. An organization called ThinkNear shows that something like 15% of all ads targeted by location in the USA, based on billions of data analysis, billions of adverts, 15% are targeted more than 60 miles away from where the person physically is. So there are significant consequences. Our IoT devices are not terribly accurate. I happen to have been lent by one of my daughters, a Garmin Vivo Smart HR. And compared with the stuff there, that sleep analysis, it kind of mostly works, but not always. There can be up to 30% difference between what different devices record. Comparing step count, for example, between my iPhone and my Garmin gadget. The Garmin gadget is around about 30% out, and I trust the step count from my phone more than from the Garmin. I can put on 2,000 steps with the Garmin in 15 minutes, sometimes just by certain movements of the wrist. That has consequences. Oh, sorry, let's move on a little bit looking at data before we look at algorithms now, analytics. We have a lot of data, and many people are using the data from social media. One of the fundamental problems we're seeing in many areas with social media analytics is there is an assumption that they have got, because I can hoover up all of the tweets, or all of the likes, or whatever, I've got all of the data. In statistics, mathematical terms, they are trying to assume that because I've collected all million tweets that are available, I have got all the data. And N, the sample size, is all. Not remotely true. Because, yes, you have collected all million that are available, but those million tweets do not represent the real population. Because those who do the tweeting or the retweeting are a highly biased, self-selected group. About 5 years ago, I think it was, Santander started looking at tweets and social media to try to understand what was going on and where some of the failures were happening with their clients. Now, they recognized that N did not equal all, that it was incredibly biased. And so what they did was to use the tweets of service failures as an early warning of possible problems. So rather than going and hammering the staff involved in that branch because they'd done something wrong that caused somebody a problem, they turned it around, and this is where leadership came in. Okay guys, we've got a couple of really upset customers. Now what happened? Let's find out, let's learn from that. It would have been so easy to have taken that analytics approach. We've got all the data and it shows you are the failing office, the failing cashier. That, of course, would have been entirely the wrong way of fixing a problem like that. It might have been a one-off problem, and the small data would have shown exactly what had happened. Not the big data, not the analytics. So we have to worry about the quality of the data we are trying to use. We need to think very carefully about N equals all or very biased. We need to think about which of the data, if we're tracking with location, maybe our fleets of vehicles, we need to do some fairly careful checking of the data as it comes in, because otherwise you'll suddenly get a report that your lorries are travelling at, you know, 150, 200 kilometres an hour for a short period because the location is completely wrong. That has been done by a company very close to Derby, where they've provide fleet management tracking systems, and they realized very, very quickly they needed to do that validity checking on the fly. When we set up the session for today for me, Marcel sent me a very interesting article, the URL's somewhere around here, about Cambridge Analytica and its influence both in Brexit and in the Trump elections. We'll be looking at that. I'll talk a little bit about activity tracking because that has some business consequences. And I guess most of you know about target and pregnancy prediction. Hands up, who knows that story? About half of you. Okay, I'll have a quick look at this. Now, data is very, very important under the General Data Protection Regulations, as are algorithms. And there are three slides that later on which kind of refer back to this. So I won't cover that yet. But algorithms, algorithmic transparency, understanding our algorithms is going to become incredibly important as of 25th of May next year. Now, the story with Cambridge Analytica goes back a year or three to a guy called Michael Kaczynski. And he showed that if you did some analysis of people's likes on Facebook, you could learn a lot about them. 69 likes could give you, with 85% confidence, the skin color. Yeah, I see eyebrows rising. 69 likes and you know whether I'm white or black. Wow. With 150 likes, you probably know that person's characteristics better than their parents do. That's how powerful likes analysis is. Might not be legal next year, as it happens. Then Alexander Nix is a bright guy. He's got a company called Cambridge Analytica. He apparently has is thought to have built on Michael Kaczynski's work and found ways of analysing social media in such a way that his company can then help the Brexit campaign, the Trump campaign, to email you or send you, through whatever medium is appropriate, highly nuanced, highly focused communications. So rather than the traditional approach in politics, which is, here we are, our manifesto and our policies, this new approach is saying, well, Richard, you are involved in this, this, and this, and this, therefore, here is a little condensed, almost, you could say, a political advert, which is phrased in terms which we know, going back to that communication point of that politician, you are going to buy into. And that, of course, is staggeringly persuasive. So our likes, our social media activity, can tell people with the right analytics an incredible amount about each of us. Should we be doing that is an interesting ethical question. Then of course you have the Target problem, where they were able, by looking at the purchasing patterns, to be able to identify women, customers, who were pregnant. And then they decide, the marketing team decide, having proven they could do that and identify which trimester of pregnancy the women were in, they could target them with adverts or discount coupons and so on. And the sky fell in when a very angry man came in, had a discussion with one of the store managers about this. So, what are you trying to do? Get my daughter pregnant? The manager said, sorry, I will find out what's going on. I'll come back in and phone you in a week. A week later, he phoned up, about to tell the angry father that he hadn't been able to make much progress, but to apologise profusely. And the father said, it's all right, I've got to apologise. There were things going on in our family that I didn't know about. Our 16-year-old hadn't quite had the courage to tell us that she was pregnant. Here, the question is, the analytics works, we can do it, but fundamentally, should they have either done that analytics on the data, or should they have even used that analytics to actually target women? We have in the UK at the moment, under the UK law, you are not permitted to use DNA profiling as part of health insurance. The health insurance companies would dearly love to be able to do that, wouldn't they? Fortunately, it is illegal. So we have some incredibly powerful predictive analytics capabilities that the Target showed, but we need to ask ourselves whether it is ethical. And to think about the vulnerabilities that some of this has in terms of our reputation and maybe even our finances. Going back to the Uber situation, if it is proven that through various mechanisms they have ended up with Google intellectual property, they could well be in line for extremely large fines, and even, I read a couple of days ago under American law, there's a lovely little thing that allows the court to essentially stop your progress for the length of time it took the originator of the IPR to develop it. So Uber could suddenly get a roughly five to 10 year stop on their development of their new autonomous cars. At the moment, the commentary has been, they took the judgment, that the fine would be less than the benefit, which is not an ethical or relatively lawful position to take. The health trackers are interesting. The bottom one is, in some respects, the least consequential in terms of business. Because what we find is people are now relying on the calorie counts. Any of you have health trackers? A few. Some people look at the calories per day that I've burnt as being the target. I want a target at 2,500 calories a day, for the sake of argument. And what has been found is that people are looking at it and say, today I've had a really great time, I've done 3,500 calories, so I've got a 1,000 calorie bonus. Hey, I'll have that Big Mac. And what we discover are people are actually putting on weight. They're not getting fitter. Consequential for the individual, probably not consequential in business terms. But the top two are much, much more significant. On the left-hand side, people. There are companies around in the USA and in the UK who are now giving discounts on health insurance programs if you use health trackers. If you meet the target, great. There's one company that is running a policy where if you do not meet your targets on a week-by-week basis, there's a £12 sterling, €15 penalty per week for failing to meet your activity targets. This is compounded not just by the inaccuracy of the gadget on your wrist, but the app that they actually gave you on your smart device, which didn't actually register very well with the service and so on. Is it ethical to have a business process like that, a business product, where there could be 20, 30% error in the data that is driving the discount? Now, if I have a Garmin WhatsApp that I was using, I would probably be quite happy because I know that I'd be 20% over target. I'm taking the company for a ride, which is a financial risk for the company. If it's not accurate enough and undercounts, that's an unethical business position, I would suggest. As was demonstrated by the one on the left, so on the right at the top, the dog. Health, pet health insurance is now being peddled. And someone had one of these, they had a golden retriever, big dog, and the target was 80 minutes of walking per day. They put the little tracker, little bone thingy that looks like a bone under the dog's neck, and took it for, over the day, about 80 minutes worth of walking. Looked at what the tracker had, or the app had actually recorded, 5 minutes. Big health insurance penalties. Hugely inaccurate device. Now, another significant area under GDPR is all of this lovely machine learning stuff. But can we be sure what machine learning is actually learning? We give it lots of training material and we do testing and so on, but there's a lovely story from not that long ago about neural network image recognition. Can you retrain the device or the machine to learn the difference between friendly and enemy tanks? They thought they got it right. But it turns out that what the machine had actually managed to teach itself was how to distinguish between forests and deserts, or clouds and sunny skies. Not very helpful if you're trying to use that to have autonomous missiles trying to take out enemy tanks. Recently, like about a week ago, that a series of images came out purporting to show brain scans of neural networks, which are remarkably resistant to human understanding. They just do something in those levels of their various networks. And so this is like a brain scan of how neural networks are working. And I just give you a couple of examples of why that's a very compelling way of looking at how neural networks work. Because These are fMRI scans where we can see where the activity is happening in parts of the brain where we know what those parts do broadly. I want to move now on to security and privacy, because privacy and security by design are fundamental aspects of GDPR. It's good practice actually, but we've not really done it properly for 50 years. Whether it's your smart fridge that is a way into your home network or your business network, Genesis Toys with a Kayla doll, which we heard about 3 weeks ago, which leaks the conversation between parents and children, or cloud pets, where 820,000 accounts on an unprotected server allowed conversations to be extracted between parents and children. IoT is a staggeringly dangerous environment at the moment. There is nothing to guide those people using them to actually install them out of the box with relatively secure hard passwords or identities. And finally, before I do the GDPR bit, there's a summary. How many ever remember a film called, or TV series called Alpha House, produced by Amazon? Anybody remember it? No. Everybody knows about House of Cards though, don't we? Interestingly, Amazon did Alpha House, and they did pilot programs and so on, and then do huge amounts of number crunching, and then get the machine, essentially, the machine recommendation is the answer. Netflix, however, do something completely different. Yes, they do the pilots. Yes, they do the big data crunching. And then they start looking at the small data. They look at what the customers are saying, not the viewing statistics, but the actual emotional feel. They then also, and most importantly, the humans involved in this process, they start thinking, their insight, their intuition, and everything else that is human, and they chose House of Cards. That's run now in its fifth series. Alpha House died in under two series. You can see that by a lovely TED talk by Sebastian Wernicke. The bottom ones are interesting and come from Martin Lindstrom, a proponent of small data. He's got a fantastic book. And comparing Walmart with Lowe's Food in the States. Walmart use massive data. They know everybody's spending patterns, they know all the stuff, all the numbers. But when he was asked to go in and help Lowe's Food in North Carolina, I forget which, he wasn't interested in the big data. Because he knew that he needed to go and talk to real individual people. And he connected experiences in Russia, Saudi Arabia, and various places to come up with something that turned Lowe's around very, very quickly. They grew very rapidly compared with every other big store around them. He also, with Lego, helped them turn around in 2004. And the insight there, the critical insight, turned out to be not big data, but it was a 13-year-old lad who, when someone from the team went in to their house, was asking, this guy liked Lego. The assumption in 2004 was that the kids of that age were time poor. They didn't have time for things, so they needed to be able to do things quickly. What they discovered, looking at the guy's skateboarding shoes, which demonstrated, it turned out, that he had spent an enormous amount of time. Time was not for it was incredibly important to him. He could use it to become the town leader, the skillful guy, the expert. And they suddenly thought, if we do that, with Lego. We don't go for bigger bricks that you can put together more quickly, but we can change the kit to be more complex, that you can demonstrate mastery. And it's that one little insight that turned Lego around in 2004-05. You couldn't have got that from big data, could you? I've got the URLs here for a really interesting document from the English Information Commissioner's Office. It goes through in very readable form some of the critical aspects about analytics and big data and data in terms of GDPR. And those of you who are involved with personal data in terms of the meaning of the GDPR, you'll find this incredibly valuable. Some of the most interesting points are the use of algorithms, the transparency thereof, our tendency to collect everything and to keep everything, which we can't do. We repurpose data all the time because you push it into a set of number crunching algorithms or that come out of the SAS model factory or whatever. And we can start finding new things which we didn't expect to when we got the data owners, that's the customers, sit agreement that we could use their data. It's the impact on people. Some very, very important stuff about the data. A very interesting commentary about profiling. And note, compared with the previous European data protection regime, it includes things like economic situation, health, personal preferences, interest, reliability. Reliability? Interesting. Their behavior, their location, and movements. And by the way, folks, if you think by collecting IP addresses that's not part of personal data, yes, it is. The IP address of every single person is now personal data. They own that data themselves, not anybody else, not even the ISP. Algorithms. This is going to be the real fun bit. If we don't know what neural networks are doing and can't explain it, that is a serious problem under GDPR. Security and privacy by design must be fundamentally built in. Good practice, I know. But we've treated security in IT over these last 50 odd years as the last of the non-functional requirements to be bothered about. Because it's complicated and it's difficult. Now, folks, it has to be first and foremost in our design process. It cannot be added in at the last moment when it's difficult and dangerous and expensive. So I leave you with the challenge. Are you leaders? Are you managers? But where will you lead your teams? Key must-read books. The top three are the ones that I've had for the last year or so. Daniel Kahneman's book on the right. Very, very interesting insight to how humans really believe and behave and think. Seeing What Others Don't See by Gary Klein is all about insights. How do we get insights? Do we really want insights? Or actually, at a senior level, are insights a problem because it contradicts what we fondly believe? The Glass Cage in the Middle by Nick Carr is all about how automation has affected us over the generations and centuries. And two ones at the bottom, my new two for this year. Live and Lead, How to Create Your Own Personal Guidance System. And A Deliberate Play on GPS to do with where you are, geolocation systems. And then Martin Lindstrom book, Small Data, The Tiny Clues That Uncover Huge Trends. The rest of the slides, I'm not going to show. They have URLs, they have references. And there's a section on the 12 V's of big data analytics and IT in general. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Richard, interesting other axis that we've seen with Alex. Are there questions for Richard? Nobody? Okay.
Ah, one.
Yeah, over there, sorry.
The question is, goes back to the veracity curve, which is increasing volumes of data. And the question is, what should we do about the fact that it's just going to continue? Will the level of veracity, the veracity problem get worse, or will it stay at about 80%? Don't know quite. I think a couple of points I'd make. One, we need to start thinking carefully about how we identify the anomalies. I've got students working at the moment in GPS tracking time series to try and identify algorithms that help, if we have the time series, to help identify which ones may be in error. And some of those may well be relevant to other areas where you have a time series or something. If you have a single point, like a couple of photos I took yesterday in the inside the hotel, which are either back at home or untagged, I'm not sure yet because I can't see it on my phone. Now, there are going to be times when if GPS tracking starts up on the smartphone, it's going to be randomly in error. We cannot determine what that is. The other point is to try to look at the variability in your data, whether you do cluster analysis or whatever, is to say, think about the vulnerabilities. If I want to do this analysis and the business question is this, what are the consequences of, say, the outliers? If we include those outliers, is that going to give us a business vulnerability? Maybe reputational, maybe financial, maybe legal. So it's to actually ask yourself the questions in the 12 V's to see what are the consequences if we include this uncertain data. And that's really all the advice I think we can do is, that's practically all that we can do, because we can't actually clean all the data up properly. It's not going to be feasible. So what are the consequences? If the consequences are relatively low, maybe we do. If the consequences of some of those outliers are enormous, then maybe we have to think very carefully. Does that answer the question?
Okay, thank you, Richard. One question, time for one question left. Someone has a question for Richard? Okay, I have one for you. Looking at ethics, who should be first responsible in the company? Is that something for the CIO, or the CDO, for the CIO, or maybe the data scientist?
It comes from the very top, the chief exec or the board. They have to set that picture. Think about Uber and Kalanick's perspective. He has driven it in a direction which clearly has not been good for business ethics or its reputation. Think about how many legal cases there are around the world about are you or are you not a taxi company or are you an intermediary, so you keep saying. It has to come from the very, very top. He must walk, or she must walk the talk. It cannot be set by the CIO. It cannot be set by the data scientists. They're far too low down the totem pole. It has to come from top, and everybody then has to work that way. Whether it's in visualization, there are still some very interesting ethical questions about visualizations. So often, we see false origin graphs, either to maximize the levels of change or to minimize it. Think about a stock exchange year's worth of data, say the FTSE 100. And if you plot it over a year, it's got sort of gentle wavy lines. False origin it to just fit between the levels it was yesterday, lower and max, and it looks like the Alpine, the the Alps. What's the message? Are you trying to mislead people? The best one I've ever come across was a government chart from about 4 years ago. This one. They presented on a log scale on the left the levels of investment in a whole range of areas, from energy, communications, flood defences, intellectual capital, transport, waste and water. And if you don't notice what's happening on the left-hand scale, you think they're all about within about 30%. It looks quite good, doesn't it? Nice balanced portfolio. Oh. And this was after we had had a winter of exceptional floods. The previous one was trying to prove that the flood defences investment was actually pretty good, isn't it, folks? Unfortunately, when the government, the bureaucrat, well, civil service guy, actually got his hands on it and said, government, you failed business presentational ethics. That's what it looks like with a traditional linear scale. You can't see the investment in flood defences. But ethics of visualization has to be practiced, but based on the message and the direction and the vision and communication from the very top of the company. And GDPR is going to be very similar. The fines of 20 million euros or 4% of world turnover is going to concentrate people's minds, not just in the Europe, but worldwide, because it affects everybody who touches European citizens.
Very clear message. Okay, dan gaan we over tot de lunch. En dan gaan we na de lunch, komt de andere groep hier terug. En hier weer een aantal andere sessies. Dus we hebben tot 13:30. Ik wens jullie een prettige lunch.
Thank you.